Hey, hello everyone. I'm Will Harris and I'm very excited to convene this online reading which features some of my favorite poets and people. The way we're going to do it is we'll have three readings to start us off, and then we'll have a conversation around those readings, and then we'll close with a poem from each of the poets. So I'm just going to introduce everyone briefly and the order in which they're going to read. So first up, we have Nina Mingya Powles, who's a poet, essayist, zine maker, and editor from Wellington. In 2019, she won the Landfall Essay Competition and the Nan Shepherd Prize for Nature Writing. Her first full-length poetry collection, Magnolia, was shortlisted for the 2020 Forward Prize for Best First Book of Poetry and the 2021 Ockham New Zealand Book Awards. She's also the author of Tiny Moons and the editor of Bitter Melon Press. Her debut collection of essays is Small Bodies of Water, Canongate, Allen and Unwin, 2021. Crispin Rodrigues is a writer based in Singapore. He is the author of two poetry collections, Pantomime, 2018, and The Nomad Principle, 2019, and co-editor of the poetry anthology Crazy Little Pyromaniacs, 2020. His poems and prose have been published in Cordite Poetry Review, Voice and Verse magazine, The Kindling, and Tiger Moth Review. He also co-organized Uncanny Yishun, a literary tour of Yishun, with fellow poet Mark Nair. He currently hosts an online literary show with the National Library Board called Head to Head, where he invites two writers each session to negotiate their works within thematic concerns. Mary Jean Chan is the author of Flesh, published by Faber & Faber 2019 and Faber USA 2020. Flesh won the Costa Book Award for Poetry and was shortlisted for the International Dylan Thomas Prize, the John Pollard Foundation International Poetry Prize, the Jalik Prize, the Seamus Heaney Center First Collection Poetry Prize, and a Lambda Literary Award. An Italian translation of Flesh by Giorgia Sensi is forthcoming from Interno Poesia in 2023. Chan's second collection, Bright Fear, is forthcoming from Faber in August 2023. I'm pretty sure Crispin also has a forthcoming collection, actually, which I didn't mention, but perhaps we'll hear from that and more about it in the reading and conversation. So I'm going to hand over to Nina first. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Will, for the intro, and really nice to see you, Mary Jean, and meet to you, Crispin. I'm really looking forward to hearing you both read and looking forward to chatting. I'm going to start with a new-ish poem, which I will read off my screen, which was commissioned by Kew Gardens and was for a while displayed in one of their gardens near a ginkgo tree. So this is a ginkgo tree poem. Deep Autumn. In deep autumn, the plant collector held the soft seeds in his hands. In deep autumn, I searched for a memory the size of a leaf blade. In his Flora Japonica, the plant collector mistakenly spelled the Japanese word ginkyo as ginkgo. Across the sea, wind spins salt and sand into lois, sheets of memory encased in glacial ice, a plastic apricot, a petrified forest. I press the leaf into the page, holding it still. In deep autumn, my mother walks the streets of Beijing, yellow leaves fanned out above her face. I'll read a short one, which is my one and only sonnet, and it's in Magnolia. Sonnet with particles of gold. Today, scientists discovered the origins of gold, the sound of egg noodles crisping up in the wok, the garden carpeted in kōwhai petals, the way my phone corrects Romati
summer to rainstorm. The day after my grandmother died was white gold in colour. A star explodes and wings are found among the debris, along with pieces of a character I never memorised. Our only name for her, poor, a woman beneath a wave. Drift, she mouths softly in English, what is drift? My mother translates into her language, not one of mine. I try to make myself remember by writing poor over and over on squares of paper, covering the walls so I am surrounded by the woman and the water radicals they hold close. The tips of waves touch me in my sleep. I will read from a little zine, which I always enjoy doing, which you probably can't see very well, but it's a small object that I made, which was commissioned by the Dead Woman Poet Society back in 2020. And so the whole zine is kind of written in conversation with the work of the American artist and poet Teresa Hak Yong Cha. So I will read a couple of a couple of pieces from this. It also folds out like this, which makes it interesting to read from. Okay. Snow language. Your handwriting resembles mine. Small looped threads, I touch them. Entering dictae, I pass through veils to enter a landscape of dust and lunar snow. You speak in remnants, gestures, utterances. Ghosts are not enough. Memory breathes. You wrote to your mother from Seoul. Every bird that migrates north for spring and south for winter becomes a metaphor for the longing of return. Your mouth opens. The sky opens. Fragments float down. Snow gloves, snow geese, snowdrops. From heavy clouds. Language of spilled water, language of mist. Before snow, after snow, snowshoes. Language of white cloth, of commas, bordered language, demarcated language. Snow blindness, snow capped, swallowed language, folded language, snowy owl, snow pea, snow drift. I am trying to listen to the silence. Snow mother, snow fall, snow fields. Your language of women is the language of snow. At the Metropolitan Museum, 1982. The heels of her boots squeak on the hard floors. Early October in New York, dried leaves and paper bones hang from the trees. After work in the empty museum, she walks along the wide corridors, her camera hanging from a strap slung over her shoulder. She faces a wall of Renaissance paintings, white skin, curved bodies, velvet. She brushes her hair out of her face. It is the hands she's looking for. Fingers, wrists, cuffs. She leans forward to study the curve of an angel's hands resting in her lap. A line of shadow can be seen under the thumb, as if her two hands are not quite touching, one of them slightly lifted in the air above the other. She raises her camera. Thank you. I'll finish there.
All right. Thank you so much, Will. And nice to see you in Unite Mary Jean.
I just want to say that, like, I'm so glad to be part of this panel, because, like, the three of you have been very influential on the forthcoming collection that I'm working on, and I thought I would read three poems from, like, the forthcoming collection. So I'll begin first with this poem that has the Chinese title, which is called Zong. So Zong, I'll explain a little bit, but it's a Chinese word that has dual meanings. The first is that it means planting, and the second meaning is race. So as in the race, a particular ethnicity. So this is the first poem that I'll be reading. So, it's no surprise that the Chinese word for race is also that of planting. In Ovid's Metamorphosis, Cadmus slays the dragon and plants its teeth in the ground, out of which sprung the Spartan race. Zong, verb, to defy biological laws of birth, to be formed from slaying. Without the aid of the Portuguese, there wouldn't be such widespread introduction of the banana, yam, cassava, maize, and sugarcane across the world. Zong, noun, the biological laws on which you were born, the laws by which you will be slayed. After the Spartan men sprung from the ground, Cadmus hurled stones at them, slaying them until only five remained. He then used them to build the glorious city of Thebes. I never had green fingers. Every plant gifted to me died, even cacti withered from root rot. Zongzu, noun, what is left, what is known, what glory can be attributed to tea filings? Farming should be a simple task. Bury it deep in soil and let rain nourish it, then leave it be. Scientists have discovered that plants display competitive behavior and may outshade their rivals or strangle them with their roots. Mother warned never to ingest seeds, or melon will grow from my tummy and emerge from the top of my head. That's how children disappear, she says. Zongzi, noun. See also changeling and sacrifice. Transplant weak shoots in solitary pots if they are struggling to grow. Part of me is rooted somewhere else. So that's my first poem. I thought I would read a second poem, which was published in Rabbit Poetry Journal of Nonfiction Poetry. And I thought I would read something to do with language and pop culture as well. So again, it has a Chinese title. It's called tree/tree. So the first tree means like song. The second tree means to clean. So this title is called tree/tree. Every verse I know, I've stolen it from somewhere. A Beatles song, a line from Chow Yun-fat as he lights a cigarette using a dollar bill while my relatives speak in ever-increasing Cantonese, their voices like joss paper floating to appease our ancestors. Solitary, on a sofa, my father sits, the only one watching intently. He taught me no Kristang words, only the sayings of John, Paul, George, Ringo. Jai Guru Deva Om. How we must come by way of Penang, by way of Goa, by way of Zanzibar, from Portugal. They tumble blindly as they make their way across the universe. He's lonely because his sister, his brother are gone across the universe. Jai Guru Deva Om. Every word I know, I've stolen it from somewhere else. My lonely father, my loud mother, my louder relatives, a Chow Yun-fat movie, my relatives across the universe, a Beatles song. Yep, so that's my second poem. My forthcoming collection, there are a series of poems titled Origin Stories. I thought I would read one. It kind of also tells you a little bit about myself. I'm born in the year of the dragon, which is actually a terrible time to be born, because just many people want to be born in the year of the dragon, and so just too many people born in that single year. But anyway, this story sort of touches on that. So this is called Origin Story. I was born 5 minutes into the year of the dragon, meaning I was precisely the weight of an ingot. While I was cradled in my mother's bosom, my tongue was cleaved by the blunt tip of a pen as my father scribbled my existence on a nurse's form, reattaching my bloodied umbilical cord to every blank the government made mandatory. He made sure to fill every gap and grid with a letter or hyphen until what was left were not blanks but sighs, signs of the trouble that was to come. My father said when I was born, the doctor spent an hour examining me before determining that my face was yellow from jaundice. Comparing scale to skin, my wings too porous for flight, lungs too weak to breathe fire. Sometimes when races mix, a monster emerges from confused genetic material. In my mother's culture, the dragon is a revered great beast of luck, the emperor's favorite. While in my father's religion, it is a metaphor for Satan, pierced in the heart by George's great spear. Here lies a baby trying to rip itself apart. The doctor kept me under observation for 3 days to see if my cells undergo further mitosis. Outside the nursery, my parents peered through the divider at their wheezing son, praying to their gods. For protection or an exorcism, nobody was sure. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, Crispin. That was beautiful. And lovely to hear Nina read as well. It's been a while since we've seen each other, so it's really nice to be sharing this virtual space today. I thought I'd read a poem from Flesh, and then I'll read 2 newer poems from my forthcoming collection, Bright Fear. So the first poem I'll read is called Practice. As a teenager, fencing was the closest thing I knew to desire. All the girls swapping one uniform for another before practice, their white dresses replaced by breeches. I thought we were princes in a fairy tale with a twist, since there were no princesses to be taken, wed. As knights, we were told to aim for an imaginary spot just above our opponent's left breast. Often, I left a bruise, the blade's tip ricocheting off chest guards onto skin. Just as often, I would feel yellow blooms of ache where the girl I thought was beautiful had pierced my heart. Hours later, I would transform. I would head back home with a deepening sense of dread, my bruises fading to quiet. So this next poem is a mirror poem, or a specular poem, for those of you who might not be familiar with the form. What happens is it's a poem in 2 parts, and the second part mirrors the first. So you read the poem back to front, but you're allowed to change the punctuation. Hindsight. All the ingredients necessary for happiness. I grew up well-fed, years away from conflict and its aftermath. When someone in the family knows sacrifice as the only currency, such knowledge seeps. History must suffice. My mother knew hunger. Bread in the absence of a miracle cannot yield more loaves. I will give myself the mango stone, save the sweet flesh for someone else. Save the sweet flesh for someone else. I will give myself the mango stone. A miracle cannot yield more loaves. My mother knew hunger. Bread in the absence of history must suffice. Such knowledge seeps. Sacrifice as the only currency when someone in the family knows conflict and its aftermath. I grew up well-fed, years away from all the ingredients necessary for happiness. And
I'll end with this poem, which is part of a long sequence called Ars Poetica. So I found myself sort of bereft of language during the pandemic for much of 2020. I couldn't write. I did not really know what the point of poetry was. I could barely read, but I did try to sort of go to poetry once in a while, and eventually started wondering what the point of poetry was in a crisis, but also was reflecting on the role of poetry in my life. And so I ended up with a long poetic sequence, partly inspired by Will's The White Jumper, in that I don't really write sequences, but I was very inspired by your sequences in Rendang. And so I wrote this, and this is the final poem in that sequence. Ars Poetica. As a child, I often considered the impact that falling in love with English had on my mother's happiness. She once said, "Don't think you can talk back to me in a colonial language. It isn't superior." I can't describe her voice. When she speaks in Shanghainese, it is sweet like water. Her language came to me as in a familiar dream, a lotus flower sinking into myself and blooming. During my first month in England, I learned the art and science of speaking to reassure. How else can I survive? It is so easy to be ashamed. I am asked why my poems are so clear. I'll confess, it's what happens when you want to be understood. 10 years ago, I found myself in Nice and learnt to dream in French, my mother's first foreign tongue. That summer, the sea was also my mother. The Bay of Angels held me in its polyphony, and I chose all my loves, Cantonese, English, Mandarin, French, spoke with a satisfaction I had not felt in years, saw my relationship to the world through sounds again, till I was reconciled, the way rainbows exist in rain. Thank you.
That's beautiful. Thanks so much. And it was so moving to hear all those voices in harmony, all those poems, so many overlaps. It's almost like it was planned, but it wasn't. not really. And it's just, I guess I feel this too. I mean, I guess I'm the only British-born poet here, or like London-born. We're all kind of writing from different places. And it was interesting, Crispin and Nina, you both started with poems about kind of about plants, about grafting, about movement. Particularly I was thinking that that ginkgo tree poem, the way you begin with the plant and with the collector, this idea of taxonomy, and obviously a lot of racial taxonomies in the 19th century came out of kind of plant taxonomies, the taxonomies invented by Linnaeus and then you end and you talk about naming, and then you end with your mother. I feel like with each of you in different ways, you're trying to kind of, you're working almost back to the personal, but you have to kind of, you know, you'll have to like swim through this sludge of like history, of namings, of misunderstandings, misconstruings. I don't know, do you feel like that's more of a common question? I guess the question is, do you feel like is the kind of journey to get back to the personal, and or like where does, okay, let me phrase it in the most open way, where do poems start for you?
You know, I think that actually poems begin inevitably in the personal for me, but then it's like maybe starting with something I've seen or a color I've seen. I was thinking about what to read today, and I was actually thinking of the ginkgo tree on my street, which is like right now at its most incredible, like luminous yellow, and the leaves are falling, and everything else is so gray except for that tree. So I've also been feeling quite bereft of language, but yeah, that tree is like, is giving me a lot of joy at the moment. So I think it might start with something like that. But then there's often a zooming out, or as you say, a swimming through sludge. But I don't know if I would call it sludge always, although sometimes it would feel like that, because absolutely there is sometimes a sense of being weighed down, like approaching a poem. That one in particular was like commissioned by Kew Gardens, as I said, and that was an interesting thing to happen. And the fact that it was commissioned by Kew made me think about, as you say, collecting, the fact that they have this like millennium seed bank, and the fact that Kew was the place where, you know, plant collectors like Joseph Banks, who's not the collector I mention in the poem, but Joseph Banks went to so many places, Australia, Aotearoa, New Zealand, the Pacific, also South America, I think, and collected all these seeds at the same time that, you know, indigenous land and indigenous peoples were being violently taken, violently killed and displaced. So there's all of that. And then, yeah, it's almost like then I can look towards those things, and in a poem you can kind of gesture towards them, but I'm so often just asking questions and I don't have any answers, and then a kind of inevitably turning back to, yeah, to family history, to memory. That's sometimes how it happens. I don't know always if it goes that way, but yeah. What about you, Crispin?
I think for me, I think poetry occurs at all the rips and tears when I try to look back at memory, or when I try to look at my family. So I've been, I think like many of you, I've been sort of struggling to write during the COVID period. And I think one of the things that I started doing was that I started cleaning my house. And I think the first thing that happened was that I went to different corners of my cupboard. And I found old photos. I found, the interesting thing was that I found books that seemed to chart like the history of colonization in the region. And I was quite fascinated with those books because there was a certain sense that they were discarded, but also they were there for a certain reason. And I started picking up these books on like, oh, you know, the arrival of the Portuguese in Southeast Asia, and I started reading them, and I think that sort of sparked an interest, because I've always been interested with the racial experience that I've had as a minority in Singapore. But it's also, I think part of it is also the sense that I'm writing from a point of biracialness, that I'm neither, you know, Chinese, nor am I Eurasian, which is one of the official race categories in Singapore. And I like to sort of think that a poem emerges from that splinter between language and splinter between racial identities. And so that's where I normally begin. And I think one of the most fantastic finds that I found during my times of cleaning the house was I found a picture of my grandparents from 1951. It was a newspaper cutout, and it was a national newspaper, and it was their wedding photo. And, you know, in those days, you would publish like your wedding photo in the newspaper. And I found it really interesting because I was thinking, oh, it's 1951. My grandmother's Chinese. My grandfather's Eurasian. And, you know, they're talking about miscegenation, you know, in the international news segment, they're talking about miscegenation in the United States, about colors and whites. And here was a mixed race couple. And I thought, oh, it's really interesting that this is on the front page. But the issues about miscegenation was on page 4. And so it's very interesting. It's like that method more than what was going on in page 4. And so I write from all these splinters and memory, but also from a lot of archiving. And I go back to myths, because I think that's the original archive that we have. So yeah, so that's where I start writing from. What about you, Mary Jean?
Yeah, no, that's fascinating. I was thinking about what Will said at the beginning, where you sort of phrased it interestingly. You said that we'd swim through this sort of sludge of history and then go back to ourselves, which I think is an interesting way to put it, because I suppose there are many ways in which, you know, poets like us, for one reason or another, are often read as sort of either confessional poets or poets who write from the personal, but in a way that's slightly reductive. I often do sort of like to problematize that framing of, you know, everything you write is diaristic, or it's not filtered through the imagination. It's somehow lesser than a conceptual book, or a book that's, you know, fictional and has all these experimental imaginative leaps of thought. But I think, you know, I was thinking about how Flesh can be seen as a book that's deeply personal, but also it's deeply historical. And because in a way, is there a self that is not historically or politically or socially situated, right? Like ourselves, we are not selves in a vacuum. And so even just thinking about something as simple as being queer in Hong Kong is political, you know, because there were things that we could imagine were possible in the 1990s and things we couldn't imagine as possible. And things have obviously changed over the past decade or two. But there are still ways in which I can be a queer person abroad. Perhaps I can't be back home. And that to me is fundamentally historical and social and personal. So I think my poems emerge from that kind of desire to kind of fuse the personal and the political, which is quite an old, I suppose, you know, way of phrasing, you know, what was prevalent in the 1960s, 70s in the US. Adrienne Rich talks about the personal as political. And perhaps in some ways we've moved on from that, but that was a starting point for me because I read Adrienne Rich at college and her work was the first poetry that felt living to me, felt alive to me. And it gave me permission to be a poet myself. I think prior to that, I felt that poetry was something I could appreciate and read and enjoy, but I could never participate in. But reading her work almost gave me permission. And Audre Lorde and, you know, so many of these other feminist queer poets of color, it gave me permission to write my own work. And so I think that's where sort of Flesh began in the interstices of like history and politics and the personal, I guess.
Yeah, that makes me think, I feel like in all of your work, there is this tension between the confessional, which always kind of shadows any writing which uses the first person, I guess, and also which has an echo of song, which you kind of brought in, Crispin. You know, when someone is singing, someone is pouring their heart out, but then there's also this archival impulse which you were talking about, which I think we probably all share, always looking for forebears, for antecedents, for explanations, for, you know, to kind of make sense of that phrase you used, Nina, the like remnants, gestures, utterances. And I was really glad you brought Teresa Hakyem-Cha into the conversation. Someone who herself, as an artist, was always drawing together languages and cultures and different kinds of texts. Maybe that would be a nice, segue into the question of language, because each of you have a different, a slightly different relationship to multilingualism, but you're all, I would say, you know, multilingual poets. And would you say at the beginning of Flesh, Mary Jean, that a poet I admire once told a British audience, we must call out monolingualism since the world has forever been multilingual. How do you feel about it now? Maybe I could start with Crispin, just because that remnants, gestures, utterances line made me think of your line about how your dad didn't pass on any Christang words. And there's always what's passed down, there's always what's not passed down, and what's passed down almost in a kind of shadow form, I sometimes think, you know, that is there but not there. And
I know what you mean. Like, so Christang, just to put everything in context, is the traditional language of the Eurasian community. So it is a sort of a middle ground between Portuguese and Malay. So Christang is sort of the middle language in which many Portuguese words, like the word Alamara, gets translated into Malay. So cupboard and Alamara becomes Almari in sort of the Malay language. And it Christang sort of captures that middle ground. And the weird thing about the Christang language is that a majority of Eurasians in Singapore, well, there aren't many of us in Singapore. I think the last census stated that we are only 22,000 Eurasians in Singapore, but the majority of them Can't speak Kristang. In fact, it's a dying language, and required a university and a couple of researchers to revive it. But the interesting thing about it was that I'm very interested in inheritance, inheritance, and I think that's the thing about language. Like, there are certain elements of language that I inherited, and there's certain ways in which I use language that is a result of the way I've inherited these feelings about language. So my feelings towards Chinese are kind of two. It's very strange because on one hand, I think as a child, I was often shamed for using Chinese because the way I used Mandarin was so bad. I used to get mocked all the time, and of all the people, by my mother. So she used to go around and tell the neighbors, my son can't speak Chinese, you know, and he's terrible at it. He's going to flunk school. And so it was a language which I feared to use because of just the shame that's associated with it. But I think the older I got, the more I realized that if poetry was meant to stretch the limits of language, and if I was a multilingual poet, then the question here was, which language do I stretch? Do I stretch English? Or do I stretch Chinese as a multilingual poet? Does it mean blending? Does it mean reading Mandarin as an reading Mandarin through the lens of English, reading English through the lens of Mandarin, treating Mandarin iconography as an ephrastic poem? So, which I do quite a lot, and so that's something that I'm really interested in. Like, what's the liminality of language? Do we stop at language in terms of its, I mean, you brought up Carl Linnaeus, right, and the idea of taxonomy, and it's taxonomy, like, oh, it's English is English. We don't think about dialect. We don't think about the way that language might be used for someone who can effectively code switch. And so that's what I'm fascinated by. So that's how I sort of employ language. But I noticed that Nina does something very similar as well. So I'm really interested in how maybe Nina might employ language in her poetry.
That gave me so much to think about. It was really, really fascinating. I think, yeah, I grew up with scraps of bits and pieces of languages around me. English is, you know, the language I write in, the language I think in, and all of that. And I share some of that shame that you talked about, Crispin, specifically as well with Mandarin, which most of the time I'm afraid to use, although I have, there's quite a lot of it like stored in the back of my brain and like in my muscle memory, but I don't get to use it very often at the moment living here in London. Also grew up with little bits of Hakka around me. My mom is Hakka. But I can't speak any Hakka, but I can recognize it. It's so familiar, but I can't understand it. So there's that gap between that gap of like familiarity and home when I hear it, and yet I can't understand the words. So I think a lot of my poetry is going into that gap, and like how much of language dwells in our body. And having spent a few years in a very regimented, very formal style of language learning when I was studying Mandarin in a kind of like full immersion setting in my early 20s, that was such an interesting experience in so many ways. And so I wrote a book about it, but it made me think of all the different modes of language learning, and like here I am kind of copying character out 10 times, which lots of kids do at school. But what does this mean like for my poetry? Like how is my creative practice connected to this process of trying to memorize, trying to hold things in my brain that I'm like constantly forgetting? So I think, yeah, language for me is so fluid. There's so much shame there. There's so much joy there. And I think it's really poets like Mary Jean, poets like Chen Chen in the US. I think it was Chen Chen who, when I speak to Chen, we have a lot of funny conversations about our relationship with Mandarin because, and this is really common, I know we have a shared kind of
childlike relationship with Mandarin. Like my Mandarin becomes most fluent like in a restaurant or in a kitchen, but like nowhere else. And that's something I was interested in bringing into poetry. Like there's a poem where I have written some like quite long lines in Mandarin, but they are like really bad, like primary school Mandarin, and that was quite intentional. I wanted to leave it that way, embarrassingly. But to capture that is my Mandarin. It is like that of a child. But I wanted to show some tenderness there, some kindness to my both my childhood self and to my fractured languages.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, that was fascinating. I think, you know, maybe I have this slightly sort of reverse relationship in that, you know, I grew up speaking Cantonese, Mandarin, Shanghainese at home with my parents. My mother doesn't speak English at all. My father does. But we never spoke English at home. So English for me was the language of school, the language of the non-family, if you will. And so that was complicated because I, you know, was born in the 1990s, and the school I went to at the time was quite common. One of those schools where, you know, you learn all your subjects in English except for Chinese. And we were explicitly told never to use Cantonese in the classroom, even during break time, you know, and even on the playground, there was an unspoken rule where you shouldn't speak to one another in Chinese. So that was language policing. But obviously, as a child, I had no idea what that was. I just thought, oh, yeah, of course, because we need to sort of oddly immerse ourselves in English, even though we're a group of Chinese girls. And somehow it's frowned upon that we would speak our mother tongue at school. And so there was always this divide for me that I just took for granted. And then oddly enough, there was a shift in my teenage years because suddenly we were being taught Twelfth Night for our equivalent of the GCSEs in Hong Kong, the HKCEs. And I was suddenly reading something that I felt was kind of forbidden if my mother knew what I was reading. You know, Cesario wooing Olivia. There was a kind of, you know, kind of undertones of homoeroticism and lesbianism and just things that I'd never encountered before in literature that felt really thrilling to me. But I was studying Shakespeare, so this was proper good stuff that I should be engaging in and devoting my time and energy to. And I remember going to the public library and just like getting all the books I could on Twelfth Night, and my mom just thought I was working really hard. But actually, I developed a sort of literary crush on Viola Cesario as a character because I saw something of myself in her or him, you know, depending on what the gender was at the time that Viola Cesario was inhabiting. So I fell in love with English because of that, because it was like a safe space where I could emerge or explore my emergent queer identity. But at the same time, I was doing something that was very linear and proper because I was acquiring English. And it felt like a very stringent environment, oddly. So it wasn't creative or playful for the longest time for me. English was something I had to perfect. I had to get my grammar correct. I had to get my, you know, vocabulary in order and make sure that I was doing English properly. And so it wasn't until like my mid-20s, I'd say, again, after encountering the poets I mentioned earlier, that suddenly English felt like a playful thing. It was no longer this serious endeavor that I had to succeed at. And obviously that's a kind of post-colonial hangover in a way that, you know, initially learning English wasn't a choice. It was key to my survival as a student at school. And eventually it became something I embraced because I wanted to. So I think I still have this like complex relationship to English and a kind of shame, slight shame with my mother tongue, which I speak and can use, but oddly still feel like if I were meeting up with friends from Hong Kong, sometimes oddly we'd speak in English. And I wonder, why is that? Why do we do that? You know, we can just converse in Cantonese. There's something about that embarrassment of using your mother tongue that is still there, I think, even to this day. So
much I want to follow up on. We don't actually have that much time. So maybe spirit of moving things along, I could have, but also linking it. I really wanted to talk about form, because each of you uses the page in such interesting ways. But maybe I wonder, in the context of what we were talking about, you know, the archival impulse and using different languages, how does that play into your use of form? And maybe you could each of you answer with an example poet, but or just if you can think of And that might be like generative to our listeners, watchers, you know, because I guess the discussion we've been having has been, although personal, also quite theoretical as in abstract, but as writers, like, how do you condense that? How do you turn that into poem? Mary Jean, would you want to go first?
Yeah, I could. So I guess the poem that kind of comes to mind, because it sort of fits what you're gesturing at, Will, is this poem called Written in a Historically White Space. And it's a poem in which I use Chinese characters, but I leave them untranslated. So there's no explanation in the poem, also in the notes page at the back of the collection. I've just left these characters unglossed. And so I think my kind of initial impulse was that I was reading, you know, some post-colonial theory, partly for my PhD, and realizing this idea of having everything translated into English automatically places English as the kind of superior language, right? It's sort of the language everything's translated into. And so I suddenly thought, oh yeah, why do we have that desire to always make ourselves transparent? And that also links to something that this poet and theorist Edouard Glisson says about the power of opacity, this power of, you know, often it's minorities that feel that we have to render ourselves transparent to the white gaze or the white reader, as if our complexity was too much. And I kind of thought, actually, I don't want to render myself transparent. If you want to understand these characters, please go and look them up, you know, engage with them the way I would with a different language. And the way I learned English was with a dictionary and with a thesaurus, and I had to look up these difficult words. And so I kind of almost wanted to offer that back to the monolingual reader. And for people who are bilingual or, you know, multilingual, then they get a completely different experience of the poem because they can read the characters. And others would just read it as a kind of erasure poem, but with enough context that they would sort of know what was going on anyway, so they could fill in the gaps themselves. And that's quite creative as well, that the reader can meet me halfway, as it were. And I thought that was also quite a generous thing, even though some people might think initially it's a kind of exclusionary act, but actually I think it's very real for you know, especially for me coming to English. But I also wanted people to engage with my reality, you know, my language taking up space on the page without having to kind of apologize for itself.
Yeah, that's pretty sure. And also, this is the poem here. Also it's an address to the reader directly. It's kind of generous in that way, and it's a prose block. And then that is also maybe a kind of generous, like, extending a hand. Because I sometimes think one of the things that people are scared of in poems are line breaks, because they don't really, why is the line broken there? What does that mean? How does that change? Whereas prose is more approachable, the thing.
Yeah, like as a prose poem, I mean, Anthony Ivani Calvadeo says of a prose poem that you can see it as a room, as a space the reader enters into, and I quite like that. And also because you're right, it's addressed to the reader, so in a way it's a bit of a short letter to the reader, as it were.
Crispin, sure.
So I did mention earlier about sort of looking at Chinese iconography as ekphrastic poems, and I do that quite a lot in this entire manuscript that I'm working on. I think one of the things that I'm really fascinated by is the same thing that Mary Jean mentioned, is the idea of not providing a translation for the reader, but sort of putting my process on the page and trying to get the reader to see that, oh, you know, that's how actual language learning happens in the Chinese classroom. But also at the same time, there are many ways in which one may interpret some of these iconographs. So I have a poem that's literally called Hua Yu, which is Chinese. And I split those two words apart. It's in two parts. The first one is Hua, and I use the sound of the word Hua. So Hua can sounds like the word for flower as well. But it also looks as the word transformation on top. So if you look at the word Hua, is the word transformation, which also sounds like Hua, and there's a 10 at the bottom. So I literally say there's transformation, there's a crucifix right there in the word. So there are all these There are all these other familiar iconographies that people might connect it to, and sort of I look at what's being crucified when we look at language in this way. And the same thing as the word second word, which is I split that word up into its different components, and really looking at Chinese, especially in the context of Singapore, as a language of transaction, to the point where sometimes it's not your own language, but you learn it because you want to do business in Singapore. And on top of that, you know, many Singaporeans are learning Chinese, especially those who are not of Chinese origin, so that they can do business with China. And so there's that sense that Chinese is now being used in the context of Singapore as a purely pragmatic language, that we're using it just for business with a larger superpower, just in case, you know, our relationship with America or the UK doesn't pan out. There's always China there in the background. So it's that kind of very weird relationship. And so I use ephrastic poetry as a way to navigate that transactionary behavior of language. Yeah.
That's really great. And I feel like that was kind of in the part of the discussion before. It feels like an important thing to bring out, that question about multilingualism. It suggests that, you know, languages, as you were saying, Crispin, are, you know, discrete things when they're not. They're made up of, you know, languages. Who said the language is a dialect with an army and a maybe bag, like, kind of, but they're really, and then a poem itself has always seemed to me like a poet invents their own idiolect for each poem as well. So they're taking the language again, which is what you're talking about doing, and subverting it. And there's obviously business speak, or like globish, as it's sometimes called, and different forms in different languages, which, yeah, the idea of any, yeah, monolith, like national identity language, all of your poems kind of subvert, really. Yeah, Nina?
Yeah, wow, just listening to both of you, though, there's so much, so many ways that our work and ourselves are connected. But what you said just then, Crispin, reminded me so much of when I was at uni and Chinese Mandarin was my major. My other major was English Literature. There was no one else who was doing those two majors. And I was the only one in the class who I felt like I couldn't really explain, like, why am I here? Everyone else is like, yeah, I'm doing international business, I'm doing finance, whatever. And I would be like, yeah, I don't know. I just want to, like, maybe talk to my grandma more, and which is so valid. But at the time, you know, when I was like 18, 19, it did not feel valid in any way. And so I've always been, ever since then, like writing about that. But I think also I've heard you speak before, Mary Jean, I think, about this untranslatability, but the decision not to translate Chinese characters specifically. I think it might have been in about 2018 or 2019 that I heard you say that in an event, and I'm sure I've told you this before as well, but that was just had such a profound impact on me and my work, as you already know. And I think your question, Will, made me think of this kind of the central sequence of my poetry collection, which is called Field Notes on a Downpour, which is like 6-7 pages long, and it's in prose, sort of. And I think this was the beginning of me realizing how freeing it is to write in the form of a sequence. And ever since then, pretty much, I feel like very often I'm, even when I'm trying to just like write one contained poem, I'm thinking of it like, how does this fit with everything else? And I really enjoy thinking of books as kind of projects, or yeah, long connected pieces. And I think it's when I discovered like the work of like Banu Kapil, when this kind of blew open the form of what a poetry book could be for me, what a poem is, and the kind of slightly arbitrary divisions between a prose poem and a poem in verse, and how kind of fluidly you could just switch between them.
So yeah, so this sequence, I decided to pull apart Chinese characters just like Crispin describes doing as well. And I kind of started it when I was in the midst of this Mandarin language course in Shanghai. And I was like trying to frantically memorize characters every week for my dictation tests. And when that became too much, I would kind of turn to kind of trying to keep a language learning journal, I guess. That is what the sequence feels like to me, which is really liberating. I didn't necessarily think of it as a poem at first. It was just me literally pulling apart characters, examining them, trying to look at them closely, thinking about homophones, just like you described, Crispin, which gives us so much rich poetic material. And it, for me, it marks, I think, the beginning of bringing multiple languages into my poems. And from there, I've just kept doing it.
Amazing. Well, thank you, everyone. Really enjoyed this discussion. Maybe we could close now with poems for Mary Jean, Nina, Crispin, that order. Just to round this up.
Okay, so I'll read this poem, which is called Postscript, and it was sort of slightly influenced by Seamus Heaney's Postscript, so this is sort of my queer version of it. Postscript. In the penultimate scene where mother and child are listening to one another, speak in spite of everything, the way an orchestra might play on bravely, even when the audience claps before its time, you will want to stay a while in subtropical winter heat. As sunlight blazes through the fog of memory, you begin to wonder if the origin story can at last be transfigured into the version redacted through the centuries, the one in which the garden comes alive, a queer child's vision of paradise, where the trees are free to bear their multitudinous light.
Mary Jean, I wanted to dwell on that a little longer. I'll read one of my more kind of disjointed and maybe playful poems. The First Wave, 14 November 2016. They request that we inform you immediately. You are standing on soft ground. The ceiling lights are swinging in the background. The waves crash, then dissipate. The first wave may not be the largest. This is a flow-on event, so do not go near. Do not stay and watch the land slipping. It has triggered other faults like a network of nerves, and the seabed has risen out of the sea. There are visible ruptures running along the landscape. This is a flow-on event, but the moon does not cause earthquakes. The ceiling lights are a typical pattern of aftershocks, and they request that we inform you. You are a visible rupture running along the landscape. Do not stay and watch your nerves slipping. There will be strong currents in the background. The moon has risen out of the sea. The first wave crashes, then dissipates. You are standing on such soft ground.
Thank you so much, Mary Jean and Nina, and thank you, Will, for hosting the entire discussion. I thought we'd close out with a poem that is at the end of this manuscript, and it's called Big Boy, and just because I want to be a real hipster about it, the boy is spelled B-O-I. So it's called Big Boy. When others say that you are wasted space, swallow them whole and spit out their bones. In your body lies a liver strong enough to consume ambrosia, a gallbladder to hold a fistful of courage, to hold a punch bag. The marrow that builds your bones holds this house and houses to come. When others command you to hold your tongue, tell them in your body lies a menagerie of creatures who have made a roost in your heart. Scale and fang and tooth and claw have found shelter. They feel no need to burst forth, but rest in each other's company. They find a reason to sleep. You're big just as God intended, and you will grow bigger still. Just remember, there is space. There is always space. Yeah, so that's it.
Thank you again to Crispin, Mary Jean, and Nina for your incredible readings and your generous discussions. I hope they can continue at some point in the real world, maybe with all the people watching. And thank you also to the National Arts Council of Singapore for their support for the virtual residency and for this event. And also to the Writers' Centre in Norwich for hosting us. And yeah, take care.